Hello and welcome. You're watching To The Point. This afternoon, Hyderabad University revoked the suspension of the Dalit students. But is this sufficient to diffuse the tension and controversy surrounding Rohit Vemula's tragic suicide? Because earlier, the story took a bizarre but disturbing turn. Did HRD Minister Smriti Irani make a series of mistakes that some believe are actually perhaps lies in her press conference yesterday when she actually claimed she was sticking to the facts? And does the newly confirmed chronology of events provide proof of government pressure and even the Vice Chancellor's links to the BJP? Those are the key issues we should examine. My guests are a professor from Hyderabad's Maulana Azad National Urdu University, Kancha Ilaya, BJP National Spokesperson GVL Narasimha Rao, ABVP State Secretary Saket Bahuguna, India Today South India Editor T.S. Sudhir, and Senior Journalist Sandhya Ravi Shankar. Kancha Ilaya, this afternoon, Hyderabad University revoked the suspension of the Dalit students. In your eyes, is this a victory for the Ambedkar Students Association and all those supporting them?
Well, it is definitely one step of the courses that whole thing has to be resolved. But Karan, the situation is much more grave. It's a whole issue is an issue of mess up. Now,
can I stop you there? I'll come to that issue in a moment's time. But first, let's begin by focusing on the revocation. When you say it's a good step, do you believe it is also partly a step towards victory, or is it short of that?
No, it's a question. The students also have been demanding revocation of the four students sitting there. Therefore, this is one of the steps that the government has to take, the university has to take. But since it has become a huge national issue, deploying a major discourse in the all edit pages of newspapers, in the intellectual circles, in the student ranks and so on, what should have been the course of the government is, in my view, simply on moral ground. First, Mr. Dattatreya should have sent his resignation on very moral ground. Okay. Because this is an Ambedkar Student Association. His letter saying that this is a casteist, extremist, anti-national activity, which is not at all there. Secondly, this government has been going on high moral ground of owning Ambedkar, you know, buying a building in London and constructing something here. See, the Dalits and Adivasis cannot be bought through buildings and all that.
Okay.
This is the kind of incident that they should reflect.
I understand.
That is number
one.
Let's stick to this issue
for now. We'll broaden the discussion later, otherwise we'll lose focus completely. T.S. Sudhir, after the revocation, which some people see as a victory, what is the mood on the campus? Are they celebrating, or do they now want the Vice Chancellor's resignation, which is also one of their demands?
Absolutely. In fact, they have quickly moved on to the next demand on their list. Remember, there are five main demands, and of course, revocation of the suspension was one of them. But just to get you a sense of what is happening on the ground, in fact, I am there at the protest site at the Hyderabad University campus, and just a while ago, a few professors came to the protest site on behalf of the vice chancellors, and they were completely booed down. They were asked to go, they were called BJP chamchas, they were called vice chancellors chamchas, and the protesting students said they do not need them on the campus. So the mood still is of confrontation. It is definitely not of celebration. They want the vice chancellor to step down. They want cases to be booked, the cases booked against Bandaru Dattatreya, the vice chancellor, and three other persons to be pursued vigorously by the Telangana police. So at this point in time, it's only the first step towards a possible victory, but they are not really entirely satisfied because they believe that this revocation of suspension would have happened one way or the other pretty soon.
Sandhya, Ravi Shankar, if the 6-month suspension is actually revoked in just 1 month, does it not also mean that the university has acted wrongly? And secondly, even though it's not saying sorry, it is in effect accepting it made a serious mistake.
Well, if you look at the chronology of events, Karan, it's very clear that the university has been struggling to sort of justify this drastic action that they have taken on the five Dalit students. Now, I'm just going to take you through the chronology very quickly. Now, you have on the 31st of August, that's the second proctorial board report. On the 12th of August, that's when the first proctorial board report says, it clears the students, it says nothing's wrong, no attack happened. Then the 31st of August, the same proctorial board comes up with another report saying that the attack did happen. That and it recommends that the students be suspended. There are protests after this. And then on the 8th of September is when the students are actually suspended. And
the point you're making, I take it,
and
is that the chronology shows,
the
point you're making, because the audience isn't familiar with the chronology, is that the chronology shows that this university has been struggling to justify the action it's taken, and having failed to justify, now it's revoked
it. Suspensions and revocations and then partial suspensions.
So now, and now when it's revoked it, is the university in your eyes admitting they made a mistake?
Well, absolutely. If there was any sort of fault on the part of the Dalit students, there is no way that the university is going to climb down to this extent and take them back, especially since the court case is pending. And a complete revocation of the suspension is most certainly a victory for the five Dalit students, the four Dalit students.
GVL Narasimha Rao, haven't you, your government and your party, ended up with the worst of all worlds? First, you were defending what many thought was the indefensible. Now the university has revoked the suspension, making your government's defense of the indefensible look rather rash and silly. You've lost on both counts.
No, Karan, I would disagree with that assessment because we have always held the view that this was a matter that was decided by the University of Hyderabad. And therefore, if the officials of the University of Hyderabad decide to review their own decision, the entire matter is rests with them. There was never any pressure. There was always a reference from the central ministry based on complaints received from the members, local member of parliament. And this has happened in the past also. So certainly the central government has actually nothing to do with the goings on at the campus.
So you think the government has emerged smelling of roses?
We deeply empathize.
So you think the government has emerged smelling of roses?
No, I think we have no. No, I think we deeply empathize with the family and with the suicide of a student. We do not want to go into the issues that really resulted in this particular tragic outcome. But certainly we have nothing to do with all the developments. It's only other parties which are jumping in and trying to politicize it and make it a caste issue.
Saket
we
Bahuguna,
have really not made this an issue.
Saket it's a Bahuguna, issue. You've heard GVL Narasimha Rao speaking on behalf of the BJP and presumably also the government and putting a brave face on it. What about you speaking on behalf of the ABVP? This suspension happened allegedly because these activists were supposed to have beaten up your president at the university, Sushil Kumar. Now the revocation suggests that in fact they were wrongly treated. Where does that leave the ABVP and Sushil Kumar?
See, even earlier when there was an action taken by the university in its final proctorial report which was submitted on 31st of August, as Ms. Sandhya also said, even then, after that, the university, after a series of protests by Ambedkar Student Association, watered down the punishment. And as a matter of fact, the students earlier were rusticated, but later it was the punishment was
and
watered
down. And now they've revoked
it
altogether. And now they've revoked it altogether, and the punishment doesn't stand. And the revocation suggests the actual punishment was a mistake. So
no,
where
no,
do
no,
you stand?
No. It does not mean that the act did not happen. Everyone on the campus knows that the president of ABEP unit, Sushil Kumar, was brutally beaten down by 30
goons
from
Ambedkar Student
Association.
But what it does mean is the act, even if it did happen, doesn't merit the punishment that was given. And that leaves you stranded.
No. In every university, when students commit such actions, disciplinary actions are taken against them. We have seen a lot of
here the disciplinary action has been revoked.
In JNU, in Delhi
but
University.
But here the disciplinary action has been revoked. Where does that leave the ABVP? That's what I'm asking.
Yeah, but this has been done under this has been done under extraordinary conditions, and this has been done because of an unfortunate incident of a death, of a suicide committed by a scholar.
Okay.
Which is very unfortunate.
Let me very quickly go to T.S. Sudhir. T.S. Sudhir, is there any response from the ABVP on the campus about how they plan to pursue this matter, or are they going to accept the outcome despite the brave words you're hearing from Saket Bahuguna in Delhi?
Well, it's pretty obvious that the revocation of the suspension would have happened one way or the other. In fact, most people tell me that the idea was to have this suspension only for a month. So perhaps by the 18th of January, barring these kind of circumstances, the suspension would have been revoked. But since we are now talking in a very different set of circumstances, when I was speaking to Sushil Kumar, the man at the center of the entire controversy, he says that he cannot enter the campus without security. He's scared of being manhandled. And if we go by the kind of scenes that we just saw about 15 minutes back, when the professors, senior professors, coming to talk to the students on behalf of the vice chancellor, the manner in which they were booed down, it does not augur well. They plan to keep the momentum going, they plan to keep the agitation going, and it does not look like the students are in any mood to call it off in a hurry.
Let's come, GVL Narasimha Rao, to another aspect of tonight's show, because I think it's an issue of national concern, and it's one on which I know Kanchay Laya will want very much to talk. And it's to do with the claims that Smriti Irani made at her press conference. Yes, first of all, she claimed that the head of the subcommittee of the Executive Council that decided to suspend Rohit Vermula and the four other Dalit students was himself a Dalit. The university's SC-ST forum has disputed this. They claim that the head of the subcommittee was Vipin Srivastava, an upper caste professor. Secondly, Prakash Babu, the dean of the Students' Union Welfare, has actually told the Times of India that there has been no Dalit representation on the Executive Council since the university's inception. And thirdly, the same SC-ST forum adds that although the Dean of Students' Welfare was a member, he was only notionally co-opted and only as an ex officio. So has Smriti Irani got her facts wrong?
Absolutely no. I think this is a motivated propaganda. I think the entire Executive Council was constituted much before our party came into government. So there was no representation from the Dalit community in the Executive Council. This is a matter of fact. And this was not constituted by our government, number one.
If it's a matter of fact, how could Smriti Irani yesterday have said that the subcommittee of the Executive Council was headed by a Dalit? It wasn't, because there is no Dalit member of the Executive Council, as you agree. And secondly, it was headed by Vipin Srivastava, who's upper caste. So how did Smriti Irani say that?
I think you're getting me wrong, Karan. The Executive Council subcommittee also did not have a Dalit member. And the new vice chancellor taking
Smriti
the
Irani
note of the sensitivity involved in this. One second, let me complete.
But I'm correcting you. Smriti Irani yesterday at the press conference.
You're not allowing me to complete sentence.
Complete.
I think let me complete. Okay, since the council did not have Dalit representation, even the subcommittee did not have one. Therefore, the vice chancellor, the new vice chancellor, got the dean of student welfare, Professor Prakash Babu, included in the executive committee as an additional executive council subcommittee.
You're not
as
saying
an additional
anything different
member
to what I said.
And it was through
but you're
him.
You're missing the point. What I said was twofold. Smriti Irani claimed that the subcommittee was headed by a Dalit. It wasn't. She was wrong. It was headed by Vipin Srivastava. That claim of hers was simply wrong. Secondly, your point about the Dean of Student Welfare being included, Prakash Babu, is countered by the SC-ST forum, who say he was only co-opted as an ex officio, which means he's not a full-fledged member. And therefore, once again, you're wrong.
I think don't get into semantics of it.
I'm not getting into semantics, I'm getting into facts. Don't belittle facts by calling them semantics when you've got the facts wrong.
He was included in the subcommittee, and it was under his, he was the one who communicated with the students. All the communication with the students who were suspended have happened with Mr. Prakash Babu.
Let's see.
Because he comes from the community, he possibly understands their sensitivity.
Well, just a moment, whether he understands it or not is another matter. Let's see whether your point that an ex officio member is the same as a full-fledged member is accepted by Kancha Elaya. Kancha Elaya, answer that for me. Do you accept the point that co-opting the dean as an ex officio means that he becomes a full-fledged member of the committee, or is he only an ex officio and therefore different to the other members? That's the first question to you.
No, see, Karan, maybe the Vice Chancellor has inducted one of the persons as a committee members and then, but the proctoral committee head was one Professor Pandey, who actually awarded the punishment. And then normally what happens in the universities, it is the proctoral committee which suggests the punishment. The executive council is only ratifying body, it does not take decision of punishments. Now what happened in this, I think, you know, GVL or any one of us should be concerned about this whole thing of structural higher education, the way it was handled. If
Kanchana, we need to keep our focus. Our focus at the moment is questioning whether Smriti Irani made a mistake or was lying.
I think that was not correct to say that the committee was headed by a Dalit and he could have been a co-opted member. And co-opted member obviously could not decide and chair the decision. That
Absolutely.
Is not possible.
So in your eyes, did Smriti Irani simply make a mistake, or was she deceiving, or was she lying? Because she kept saying at that press conference, I'm sticking clearly to the facts. And when she gets the facts wrong, is it a mistake, deception, or a lie?
No, obviously the committee that she sent submitted a wrong report, and based on the committee's report, she tried to give that information to the nation. But the fact is that that is not true.
Okay.
So therefore, what I am saying is that there has to be a major reshuffling of the structure itself.
Yes, sir. We'll come to that later. Please, let's stick to the questions I ask. Otherwise, we lose control of the show. Let's take them step by step. I will come to that in a moment's time. I promise you, Kanchalaya. But let me structure the show for the audience who's not aware of the details as well as you are. GVL Narasimha Rao, there's a second error that Smriti Irani made that I want to focus on. She said that the warden of the hostel in which Rohit was expelled from is also a Dalit. And the SCST forum points out that this is irrelevant because hostel wardens don't have the power to expel students. The Dalit warden of the hostel was only implementing orders he'd received from higher authorities. Once again, the accusation is that Smriti Irani is misleading the country by citing the fact she cited. This is an irrelevant fact that she cited to try and suggest that a Dalit warden was in agreement when it's an irrelevant fact.
No, how can you say it's irrelevant? I think she was only pointing out that unfortunately this has been made into a Dalit versus non-Dalit issue, and there was an attempt at every stage to involve members from the community to be a part of the decision or a part of that implementation. So that the sensitivities can be observed. I think the executive authority lies with the executive council, and the vice chancellor actually got the executive council, of which he is the chairman, to actually be more lenient than the original punishment that was advised by the proctorial boards, which was to completely
rusticate
them for a semester.
Just a moment. I think the test of what you're saying, T.S. Sudhir, presumably is, do we have any idea what the warden of the hostel himself thought about expelling Rohit and the others? Do we know whether he thought it was the right thing to do? Or was he simply obeying orders he'd received, even though he may not have agreed with them? Do you have any idea about what that warden thought?
Well, if one is to go by the voices on the campus and what one has gleaned from talking to people in the university administration, most people say that they were on the same page, that the line had been transgressed as well as discipline was concerned, that they should not have gone and manhandled 30 of them of the Ambedkar Students Association. And going by the version of Sushil Kumar, they pinpointed to these five of them who had actually assaulted the ABVP activists, which is how this entire decision to reward punishment to these five was taken. And the vice chancellor, the members of the executive council subcommittee, as well as the chief warden, seem to be on the same page. That's the impression that the university administration is giving, which is why all these students are targeting each one of those members, whether it's the vice chancellor or the warden or members of the EC subcommittee, that they were all together in actually awarding punishment to 5 Dalit research scholars, and punishment of this kind where they were handed over a social boycott where they could not enter either the hostel or the administrative block.
We have a very interesting situation, Sandhya Ravi Shankar. You have a HRD minister at a press conference yesterday, not once, but repeatedly saying she was simply sticking to the facts. In fact, she admonished other people when they asked her questions of opinion. She said, no, I'm sticking to the facts. And now it emerges that she got one fact completely wrong. She claimed that the subcommittee was headed by a Dalit. It wasn't. It was headed by Vipin Srivastav, who's an upper caste person. And she clearly has presented a second fact in a light in which it's misleading. When she said that, in fact, there was a Dalit member. The Dalit member transpires was only an ex officio member. He was co-opted to give representation because otherwise there would have been no Dalit representation. But an ex officio can't actually determine the decision the committee takes. He's only ex officio. So where does that leave Smriti Irani? I'm going to put you the question I put to Kanchalaya. Did she get her facts wrong by mistake? Was it deception? Was it lying?
She's certainly going to have to answer those questions. But Karan, let me point out one very specific and basic question that Ms. Smriti Irani definitely needs to answer. And this is that she said that the MHRD taking so much of interest in this case and sending emails and letters asking for explanations every 2 weeks to the Vice Chancellor of the University of Hyderabad. Now, she said that this was purely procedural. But the point is that Bandaru Dattatreya's letter to her did not ask for any action. He did not say, please intervene and take action in this matter. He ends the letter by saying, I am just bringing this to your notice, and I hope that under your leadership, things will change. And
well,
that's about
forgive
it.
Me,
He's
forgive
not
me,
asking
I,
the MHRD
me.
To take
I,
any
I
action
assume,
whatsoever.
And most people will assume, that when an MP who's a minister brings something to the attention of a minister and he believes something wrong is happening, he wants action. Whether he asks for it or not, that is to be assumed. Otherwise, why write the letter? So I think let's move away from that point, because clearly any person would have assumed that is what Bangaru Dattatreya was asking for. But come back to my key questions that I want to put both to Saket Bahuguna as a member of the ABVP and then to G.V.L. Narasimha Rao. We've just established conclusively that Smriti Irani, although she claimed she was sticking to the facts, got one fact wrong and presented the other in a very misleading light. Where does that leave Ms. Irani? First you, Mr. Bahuguna, and then G.V.L. Narasimha Rao.
See, if the facts have been mistaken, the facts must have been given to Mrs. Irani by the officials. But the point is that will now all the debates in the country will focus on whether the perpetrators of a crime, whether the accused in a case are treated, are judged by people from the same caste or community. Tomorrow, people from certain community will come and say, we have been not
treated
properly.
Forgive me, but that is the point Smriti Irani was trying to make herself when she kept insisting that the subcommittee was headed by a Dalit, that his membership was Dalit, that the hostel warden was a Dalit, therefore suggesting somehow he was involved in the decision, which he wasn't. She was making that point. So you're arguing with her.
No, I'm arguing with everyone who's talking on this, because it's very unfortunate that in a democratic country like us, if Dr. Ambedkar would have been present today, he would have been really saddened by the way we are debating, because we are looking at the caste and community of almost every person.
We
are looking at the caste of the VC.
Mr. Bahuguna,
we are looking at the
caste
of the
doctor. You have a very good point, but the point should be made to Smriti Irani. You're finding an additional fault with her press conference and the logic of the defense she was putting up, and I applaud you for doing so. But the argument should be made to Smriti Irani.
No,
let me bring in G.V.L. Narasimha Rao.
That's because the debate has been going in that direction.
G.V.L. Narasimha Rao, I want you to have the last word on this before I take a break and come back to other things. There's no doubt in anyone's mind that when Ms. Irani yesterday claimed she was only going by facts and nothing else, and she kept saying, I'm only sticking to the facts, that actually she ended up getting one fact wrong and interpreting the other fact willfully, misleadingly, so as to perhaps mislead the audience. Now, I ask you that question. Did she just make a simple mistake? Was she deceiving or was she lying? Or was she misled by her juniors, if that's how you want to put it? Was she misled by her bureaucrats?
No. No, I think you must appreciate her forthrightness and willingness to come out with facts and address the
but they
press
weren't
conference.
Facts. They were wrong.
I think she needs appreciation
when facts are wrong,
for this.
They aren't facts.
No, I think Chief Warden, no, let me No, the chief warden who communicated punishment to the students is a member from the Dalit community. So how can you say this is wrong?
But that's
this
not the fact I'm talking fact. About. He I'm may not talking have had what is say. Wrong is the claim he that the subcommittee okay, headed the other by fact. Dalits. And secondly, that point that she made about the hostel warden, as if the hostel warden was part of the decision when he hasn't got the power to take that decision. Yet she presented it as if he was. Those are the facts I'm talking about.
No, I think one can, if one misinterprets her statement, you cannot blame her for it. She
I'm
said the matter was communicated to the students by the chief warden. No. I think chief warden is from the Dalit community.
But I'm not talking
and he's
about
the one
the
who
chief
communicated
warden.
The decision right. to the students. So one matter, you have to concede on one factor. The second one, she also said dean of student welfare, a member from the Dalit community was included in the subcommittee.
As an ex officio at the SCST forum pointed out,
I have not heard
a full-fledged membership.
It does not matter.
Mrs. Irani
it does not matter. It does not matter.
No point in me arguing.
I have not heard say he was the chief.
Questions. You've established from your answers that you don't believe that she got it wrong. You believe that somehow, even when the facts are wrong, the minister is right. Maybe there is a sort of divine right of ministers that they are right.
No, Rahul Gandhi is the one who got it wrong.
I'm happy to accept that. Welcome back, you're watching To The Point, and we come now to the new chronology that's emerged that raises worrying questions about the government's role behind the action taken against the Dalit students. Sandhya, Ravi Shankar, let's come to the chronology that you were citing in part one. On the 12th of August, the Proctorial Board came out with a report that there was no medical evidence to prove Sushil Kumar was beaten by the ASA activists. On the 17th, Bandaru Dattatreya wrote to Smriti Irani calling them anti-national and presumably asking for some sort of action to be taken. On the 31st, that is 14 days after Dattatreya's letter, the Proctorial Board changed its position and suggested suspension of the students. Does that chronology suggest that the Proctorial Board's change in stand was influenced by Dattatreya's letter?
It certainly looks like it, because this, after the first Proctorial Board's report was submitted, something called an extended Proctorial Board was formed by the university, and this was just an addition of a couple of members from the Teachers Association, and they called it an extended Proctorial Board. No reason has been given, in fact, as to why the Proctorial Board had to come up with yet another report out of the blue after they had submitted a report already. So, a very suspicious set of circumstances, certainly, if you look at the chronology.
T.S. Sudhir, the problem with that chronology and the interpretation that I've put on it is that the first formal official letter from the HRD ministry in connection with Dattatreya's letter was only written on the 3rd of September, 3 or 4 days after the 31st of August. Now, does that contradict the interpretation I've been putting across? Or could it be that informally and verbally, pressure was mounting on the university from the 17th onwards when Dattatreya wrote his letter? Which of the two is it?
Well, it could be anything, because Dattatreya's letter, which was interestingly on the 17th of August, and you have about 14 days later where the the ASA members, the Ambedkar Students Association members, are suspended or handed over a suspension. Now, what kind of a role did Dattatreya's letter play in that? We do not know, because at least officially, the Proctorial Board was not aware that Dattatreya, the Union Minister for Labour, had written such a letter to Smriti Irani. We do not know whether there were any phone calls exchanged between the HRD Ministry and the Vice Chancellor informing them unofficially, not written, that a letter of this kind was written. In fact, Arvind Kejriwal, the Delhi Chief Minister, in his very typical manner, said that the call records of Smriti Irani and Bandaru Dattatreya and the Vice Chancellor should also be checked and verified if any such phone calls were made. So, a lot of allegations and counter-allegations and kite-flying also perhaps taking place, that some kind of an indication could have been given that the report should be tailored in accordance to what Bandaru Dattatreya's letter had perhaps wanted. So at this point in time, a lot of conspiracy theories definitely going around. But yes, as you mentioned, officially the first reminder from the HRD ministry came only on the 3rd of September to the Vice Chancellor and the Registrar of the University.
Kancha Ilaya, even if the chronology I've cited is not clearly conclusive, it is suggestive. And as T.S. Sudhir pointed out, Arvind Kejriwal today, because it suggested, was demanding that the call records of Dattatreya and Smriti Irani be looked at. Do you believe that this whole issue needs to be thoroughly investigated by an independent investigating authority agency so that we get to the bottom?
In fact, Karan, I have been asking right from the beginning, there should be a judicial inquiry into this, because the whole process got bungled by putting a man whose material is not a capable material to run the university on autonomous level, autonomous structures.
Are you talking about
Appa
Rao?
From there, the...
Are you talking about Appa Rao
himself? Because he... Yes, Appa Rao... See, the Smriti Irani's statement also is based on their own facts, which are absolutely wrong, given by the Vice Chancellor's administration. This misled the whole MHRD itself. The second one is that then this started... The Dattatreya's letter, ABVP puts pressure on him, he writes letter, and then the cycle began of putting pressure by knowing that there are no proper structures. The Vice Chancellor could not register, no, this university functions on certain manners, there could be an ombudsman, there could be proper, some kind of an independent judicial official could have been okay. appointed there, as Maulana Azad University is doing now.
Can I put something else to you, Kanchalaya? You raised the role and the inappropriateness of the appointment of Professor Appa Rao. The new chronology that's emerged also raises questions about the role the different vice chancellors have played in the punishment that was given. I want to put that chronology to you. This is what happened after the proctorial board decided on the 31st of August that the students must be suspended. First, Professor Sharma, who was then vice chancellor, briefly imposed the suspensions but then revoked them. After revoking them, he constituted another inquiry committee. Thereafter, Professor Sharma literally within days retired, and after his retirement, the inquiry committee he'd appointed declined to inquire into the matter. At this point, Professor Appa Rao takes over as vice chancellor. He appoints a subcommittee of the executive council to look into the matter, and that subcommittee decides to enforce the proctorial board's recommendations, which had been set aside by Professor Sharma. And the question I want to ask you, because it's the question this chronology is clearly suggesting, is did the change of vice chancellor make a critical decision to impose the suspension? Was it critical to that decision to impose the suspension?
Absolutely, Karan. An in-charge vice chancellor cannot make very serious decisions to really run the institution on autonomous basis. They go this side and that side. When a regular vice chancellor came, he should have carefully studied this, simply should have called a district level judge and hand over the whole case to him to study. That's what universities do, and they are called ombudsmen in permanent position, and they can be done on a temporary position also. Instead of doing, based on the letters that the minister was writing, the ministry was writing back, not once, twice, second, he could have said, no, there is a procedure in the university, we cannot go with your pressures, let us take our own time, there is High Court issue there. He could have put the whole thing before a judge.
Okay.
Retired judges are available in this country. Many universities do this.
I want very much to give G.V.L. Narasimha Rao, who speaks on behalf of the BJP, as well as Saket Bahugana, who speaks on behalf of the ABVP, time to respond to the two chronologies. But first, I'm going to go to T.S. Sudhir before I come to them. T.S. Sudhir, newspaper reports today suggest, and I'm talking about the Times of India, that Professor Rao is close to the BJP. And the paper explicitly says that it was Venkaiah Naidu who pushed for him to become Vice Chancellor of Hyderabad University. Does that suggest that Appa Rao perhaps took a different line compared to his predecessor R.P. Sharma on this critical question of imposing the punishment, the suspensions?
Well, if Well, Karan, if you put two and two together, it would appear so. Yesterday, when I asked the Vice Chancellor Aparao about it, he said there are 195 candidates in all, and he was selected from amongst them. Previously, there were allegations that outsiders were being imposed on the Hyderabad Central University campus. Professor Aparao is someone who has spent 27 years here, mainly in teaching positions and briefly as a warden. So in that sense, he comes with someone with a rich teaching experience and a bit of administrative experience also. And this is perhaps what his supporters on the campus say actually helped him get the top job here at the Central University campus. Yes, there are allegations that he's a close friend of Venkaiah Naidu. In fact, he was told by one of the students that there are photographs of him and Venkaiah Naidu sharing a stage together, something which he has denied. He says there is no photograph of him and Venkaiah Naidu at any function together, but even if it was there, he believes there is really nothing wrong. But yes, Professor Aparao's closeness to the BJP, closeness even to the Telugu Desam, which is the ruling party in Andhra Pradesh, and he's a partner in the NDA, is also well known out here in circles in Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. So yes, people putting two and two together and believing that that may have played some part in the decision as far as the decision to expel these five students was concerned.
GVL Narasimha, you've been listening very patiently to these two chronologies that I've delineated. Now's your chance to respond to them. The first chronology is the one that suggests that in fact the punishments were imposed under pressure from the letter written by Dattatreya. The second chronology is the one that suggests that it was the change in vice chancellorship that led to the punishments being imposed.
Yeah, I'll quickly answer. Please allow me enough time. Number one, the committee that was constituted by the previous vice chancellor did not have the authority to override the recommendations of the proctorial board and executive council. Both of them are statutory bodies. So therefore, for a committee to override is impossible. Therefore, it was a bad idea. So when the new VC came in, he constituted a subcommittee of the executive council and got them to agree to a more lenient punishment than what was originally recommended. But also, let's understand the fact, the matter is already sub judice in the Hyderabad High Court. I think Sushil Kumar, who was beaten up, I think he went to the court, and court was repeatedly asking the university to take action, to file an action taken report in that particular matter. So the university could not have delayed matters anymore. And coming to this conclusion that MHRD may have had a say, if verbal instructions could get the decisions in your favor, would anyone be foolish to write letters? I think it's very illogical, silly for anyone to think that we wrote a letter after a decision was made. But there is if a letter was not required, why would anyone write letters? So I think to assume that these letters have anything to do with the decisions made by the university are patently false. The ministry was under obligation to refer to the university.
I want to put that point you made to T.S. Sudhir. T.S. Sudhir, what you're hearing there is a reply and a response to the suggestion that perhaps unofficial phone calls were made. Arvind Kejriwal demanded that the call records of both Dattatreya and Smriti Irani be checked because he suspects they were making unofficial calls to put pressure. What Narasimha Rao says is that if unofficial phone calls is sufficient to put pressure and secure the punishment and the suspension, why then bother with subsequent letters? Because the truth is the letters were all written subsequently. And that's not a bad point. How do you respond to it?
Well, I think he has a fair point. If the same thing could be achieved by making a couple of phone calls to the Vice Chancellor or the registrar of the university, why send this repeated reminder, some four of them, and another email which was also sent by a senior bureaucrat of the HRD ministry. And the Vice Chancellor making the point that he did not bother to reply to any of the reminders, which is why constant reminders were being sent, repeated reminders were being sent almost every month to the university here. So he believes that the fact that he did not reply to those emails, he did not reply to those reminders, is proof that he did not succumb to any kind of pressure, and the decision to expel them and actually water down the punishment was an independent decision taken by the executive council subcommittee. But given the fact that the entire thing has been polarized on caste lines, has made this entire issue very murky, where the issue of reminders, unofficial phone calls, a lot of conspiracy theories are being spun to see to it that somehow there is this caste angle which is completely enveloping this entire issue where Rohit Vemmala died last Sunday.
Very, very quickly, Saket Bahuguna, I want to give you the last word, but forgive me, we've only got 30 seconds left. explain to the audience how the ABVP looks in the situation now, when most people believe it's been resolved in a way you wouldn't like.
No, in this chronology, one point is missing. On 12th of August, when the first proctorial board was formed and it conducted an inquiry, Sushil Kumar did not depose before the inquiry committee, and that is precisely why, because he was in the hospital at that time. Later, when he joined the inquiry and we gave his statement and he presented it hospital his hospital okay. report, it was all clear that violence actually happened. And Ambedkar Student Association
and
itself accepted that 30 people had gone.
Justifies the fact that the proctorial board came to a different conclusion on the 31st compared to the 12th, because on the 12th they weren't able to talk to Sushil Kumar. By the 31st they had, as a result of which they changed their opinion. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
All right.
Of course.
That may well be the truth. That needs to be verified and established by other authorities. That could be an explanation. I simply leave it hanging in the air.
Should be an inquiry.
Because we
there
aren't in a position to get to the bottom line to know whether that is the actual truth or not, but that is a plausible explanation. I'm afraid at that point we've run out of time. What we are left with is a series of issues that hang in the air. Questions and statements delivered by the minister as fact which turn out to be either wrong or just misleading. A chronology that is at least suggestive, maybe not conclusive, but at least suggestive of influence from the ministry, and perhaps even how the change in chief vice chancellors led to a particular decision. But these are all issues that need to be inquired into. The bottom needs to be established fundamentally and truthfully. And maybe that's why Kanchala is right when he says a proper inquiry is needed. My thanks to all my guests, and if you have been, thanks for watching. Goodbye, good night.
Country's parliament right in front of the Russian embassy in Kabul. Eyewitnesses say it was a suicide car bomb in front of the Russian embassy. A number of casualties.
What's up, Delhi? So who are the chicks and cookers who are coming on stage?